on this painting that's off the camera. You can't see it. It's the one with the path. I just added some white. And while my brush has still got some white, I'm going to get started on this painting. New one. Very excited. It's always exciting to start a new one. Which means you got to let this one go, Alys. Stop. Oh, okay, who knows? I'll come back to that one another day. Anyway, this one is going to be called The Vaulted Sky, or Above the Vaulted Sky, or something like that. There's a John Clare poem that I really love. In particular, I really love the lines in the poem that have to do with the vaulted sky towards the end. So, surprisingly for some of you people out there, and wherever you are, I'm using bright yellow. Not blue. My vaulted sky is full of sunshine. So I don't think the poem is that positive sounding, but I can't remember all the lines. Maybe next time I'll have a copy of it that we can read. I didn't think to do that. Didn't think to print that out. If I was one of those savvy young tech people, I'd just Google it on my phone and get it right there. I may do that. We'll see. Anyway, the vaulted sky. Above the vaulted sky. As usual, my texture is a little too heavy, but I like it that way. This one seems to be super heavy. Like, physically, the canvas is now very heavy. So, don't really want to put a lot of yellow paint on my part of my, over the top of the canvas. So let me get this part done. I didn't want to get paint on my easel top, so let me put some thick paint up here, and then we'll kind of let that dry while I'm doing the lower portions. Vaulted sky. I don't know, this one, what does the vaulted sky mean to you guys? To me, it's kind of a spiritual thing. I don't know. Not sure what John Clare was thinking when he wrote his poem. I guess I could Google that too, but because Google knows everything, but I kind of think of the vaulted sky, or the sky in general, is symbolic to me of, and probably a lot of people, of heaven and stuff like that. So that's kind of spiritual, whether you're a Christian or not. You know, there's some association to be made with the heavens, I guess, the sky, and spirituality. So, I painted a lot of paintings with it, you know, the sky is rainy, effects of rain, different things like that. I haven't done that many, they just are about sunshiny days. So, this is hopefully going to be a sunshiny day painting. I think when you have hidden disabilities, positive disposition is important. It's very important to have a positive outlook no matter what you're going through, whether it's health problems or other problems. But my project is about hidden disabilities, so I tend to talk in terms of life with hidden disabilities. But obviously, any life has challenges, any life can have difficulties. And sometimes I think that one of the lessons I've learned in my life with hidden disabilities is to try to stay positive, keep moving forward, don't limit yourself, but at the same time be respectful of your limitations, especially if your disabilities are physical, you know, if you have things that impinge upon what you can do physically. And, you know, there are a lot of hidden disabilities that impinge upon people physically, and the outside world may not understand those disabilities. But that's part of what we're trying to raise awareness with these paintings is, hey, you know, just because you can't see it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. So, hey, it's just like God. So see, it is spiritual. that was a joke. Anyway, I was talking to a friend of mine who has stopped by for today's open house, and we were talking about what some people might call more temporary disabilities, like if you have an injury, or even if it's not technically an injury that you sustained in an accident or something, you can have a temporary problem, you know, a hip problem or knee problems or something that may require surgery, but you're going to get it taken care of. It can be fixed, you know, for lack of a better phrase, it can be cured, you know. And she was expressing that it's kind of frustrating to go from being that healthy individual who, you know, all her friends and everybody know her as being very active and capable and jump right in and get things done. And since she's had this hip problem, you know, she's had to cut back a lot. And, you know, of course, you deal with the repercussions of that when people don't understand what may be the cause of that. And so she's experiencing a little bit of kind of the what I call the blowback, you know, from having something not quite physically fit going on in your life and how the world sees you. I don't want to sound negative at all, ever, but it is true that, you know, the world at large, the general population, does not understand hidden disabilities, invisible disabilities. I can't stress that enough in our discussions and everything I'm trying to do, is that a lot of the stuff that I'm painting about or talking about has to do with my experiences of people not understanding that I'm as sick as I am, because I don't look as sick as I am, and that's been true almost my whole life. So that's kind of what my friend was talking about, and I think that's important. I don't know if you can tell from the distance of the camera, but I put this texture on this painting really thick. And actually the painting, the canvas itself is not, probably not quite half inch or 3/4 inch. It's not super thick, the canvas itself. And I intentionally put probably more texture weight on here than a canvas this size can support. The reason I did that is because as the texture dries, sometimes it'll crack and pull away from the canvas a little bit, and I like that effect. You know, you remember my painting Fault Lines. It kind of goes along with that whole idea of things happening underneath, hidden, that seriously impact but may not be visible at the outset, in real life. I mean, in my paintings, I'm trying to make that invisibility visible. I'm trying to make those fault lines actually visible. I feel like people with hidden disabilities, invisible disabilities, deal with those things in their lives, but the outside world, the people that they interact with, don't necessarily see those flaws, those God, I hate to call them flaws, that's not what I mean, but like the physical realities that the people deal with when they have hidden disabilities are things that can cause destruction and damage. You know if you have a certain disability, you know what your limits are. Okay, so for example, if you have, as I do, chronic heart failure, you know you have to be careful. You have to stop when you're doing something and you start feeling lightheaded, or you know that if your feet and ankles start to swell, you gotta call your doctor, because that means something's not right, something's not working right. So those are what I think of as the fault lines. It's like the warning signs, but it's also the condition that lies underneath that causes those symptoms, if you will. And so I'm trying to let my paintings show some of those and actually, this one in particular, I put that texture on so thickly. Is that a word, thickly? Because I almost want some of the texture to fall off at some point. Like, if that happens, I'm fine with that. I'm not, you know, going to force it. But if any of this texture does come off, I think that might add to that, the expose, if you will, of the kind of things going on underneath the surface when you have hidden disabilities. Because you can have hidden disabilities and look pretty darn healthy. I mean, people who don't know me really well, and even some of the people who do know me really well, tend to be, well, it's almost like they don't believe me. You know, I think I've talked about that before. They just don't believe that I have the health problems that I have. They don't believe that I have an incurable lung disease that I've had since I was a little kid that potentially is deadly. They don't believe that I have the heart problems that I have because I don't look sick. I rarely look completely decrepit. I don't know how else to put it. I mean, physically I'm pretty decrepit, but I don't look like it. I can still walk. I can still talk. It's just a kind of a constant battle, if you will, that I fight with as good grace as I can. But when people say, "You don't look sick," when I try to explain to them why I can't do something, or I can't participate, or I can't work that job, or I can't do this or that. And, you know, especially with employment, I've lost every job I've had because of my health problems. You can't have pneumonia all the time and hold down a job. You just can't, not unless your family owns the company. And my family never owned the company. So, you know, employers want people who show up. And since I can get pneumonia within 20 minutes at any given moment, that's just how my lung disease works. Even though I'm on antibiotics 24/7 of one kind or another, I can literally get pneumonia within 20 minutes. And I mean full-blown soaring fever, vomiting pneumonia. I mean bad pneumonia. And typically that's a 2 to 3 week crisis for me. That hopefully other antibiotics will stop the infection, but it isn't something that I can control, and it's not something I can avoid 100%. I know certain things are more risky, like I don't, you know, go out in the wintertime as much because going from a warm, heated environment out into the cold is a trigger for my lung disease. Extreme changes in temperature or environment can actually cause me to have pneumonia. So it's a little hard if you're at work and suddenly within, you know, 20 minutes you've got a fever of 101, 102, 103, something like that, and you're deathly ill and you need 3 weeks off of work. Well, you guys tell me what job that's going to be, where you still get paid and you get your benefits and you're still employed at the end of those 3 weeks. Because I'll tell you right now, I have not found that job. You know, if anybody out there knows what job that is, send me a message because I want that job. Full benefits, decent salary, can take 3 weeks off at a time with pneumonia, any given minute, weeks after weeks, because sometimes I just get over one pneumonia, I have 3 good days, and then I have pneumonia again. So tell me what that job is, and believe me, I'll apply for it. Short of that, you know, I get the, "But you don't look sick," an awful lot. So that's a little frustrating, and I try to handle it gracefully, but I do get irritated sometimes because a lot of people act like I can't have a job, but somehow that's my choice. And I'm always like, "Dude, you know, trade me. I'll give you my lungs and I'll take your boring job that you hate, but that helps support your family and provides you benefits and makes you feel like you're, you know, contributing to society and all that good stuff that jobs help us do and help the economy and be a part of the country and all that good stuff. And I'll take that any day over disability. And I think almost anybody who's disabled would say the same thing. So we're not sitting at home eating bonbons. We're trying the best we can to be as vital and part of life as we can. And if I sound a little defensive, it's because sometimes I get a little defensive. But I don't mean it in a bad way, really. It's just sometimes it's hard to feel like people don't really understand. It's just a fact. It's a truth that comes with the territory, but that doesn't make it any easier sometimes. So that, anyway, back to the painting. What I'm trying to do with some of these paintings is show some of these different emotions that come, not just the physical sensations of the particular diseases or illnesses that are hidden disabilities, but some of the emotional side of that, of life with dealing with these issues. When you're a kid, if you guys know any children who have rare or disabling conditions, you know, try to imagine what that's like from a kid's point of view. They have absolutely no control. They have probably no choice. It's not like they can choose to not be sick anymore, to not have that condition. And yet it's highly probable that most of their peers, their classmates, even their teachers, do not understand what those kids are going through. I mean, they might, you know, you first tell somebody you have a problem, a disability, something that's devastating, sure, there's sympathy, but it's like people forget, you know, you can tell them and they're like, oh, that's so horrible, oh, I don't know how you stand, oh, how do you live, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, 2 weeks later, say, for example, it's your boss or your teacher, and they're like, well, if you don't have your homework done, then you're going to fail. And your boss would be like, well, if you can't come to work, we're going to have to let you go. And so it's not that they're not sympathetic. They have a job to do, and they have parameters. I mean, you would think a teacher would let a disabled kid, you know, make up work or something, but I can tell you when I was growing up, that wasn't really the case. If you didn't get your work done, you didn't get your work done, and there was, you know, no excuses. So, and, you know, that's not a bad thing. I mean, I don't think I'm saying that people with disabilities should be treated completely differently than people without disabilities, but I think what I am saying is that normal challenges in life just are a little harder sometimes for people with disabilities, and it's that understanding of that fact that I'm hoping to shed some light on, because I think it's important for people to recognize that, you know, not everybody has the same experiences. And I think that's kind of what I'm trying to work on with this artwork. And